and it was beautifully embellished with gold mosaics, and the space is incredible. For Mehmet, it was a great booty.
Inside the church, a Turkish voice rose, proclaiming in Arabic the first pillar of Islam. There is no God but God. Muhammad is his messenger. The single greatest church in Christendom was now a mosque. The Hagia Sophia became the inspiration for all Ottoman-domed mosques to come. But none would ever match its size and scope. And it belonged to Mehmet the Conqueror. News of his triumph sent shockwaves around the world.
For Europeans, it was a concomitant disaster. Constantinople was, after all, the new Rome. It was Constantine's capital city. It was the symbol of Christian dominance in the East.
The Ottoman rulers had long stacked up titles for themselves. Khan, which is Turkish for emperor. Shahi Shah, Persian for king of kings. And Sultan, the Arabic word for ruler. But now, with all the former Byzantine Empire under their command, Mehmet and his successors claimed yet another title, Holy Roman Emperor. The Ottomans had reached the gates of the West and were poised to push on towards what they now claimed as their ultimate destiny, the conquest of Europe. That quest would fall to the most legendary sultan of all. He was born at the beginning of the 10th century by the Muslim calendar, and he was the 10th sultan descended from Osman. He was a child of destiny whose greatness was expected.
In the parlance of the day, he was the Sahib Quran, the universal ruler, the master of an auspicious conjunction whose coming has been foretold, whose identity is confirmed astrologically.
His name was Suleiman, after Solomon, the wise king of the Old Testament. The Ottoman Empire would reach its apex under Suleiman's reign.
Suleiman was extremely well educated. He was trained to the sultanate from the day he was born.
As a young prince, he formed a relationship that would have a tremendous impact on his life and on the empire as well.
And when he was still a crown prince, he also developed a great friendship with a convert, a Greek convert, who took the name Ibrahim.
The two were very close in age and apparently very close in other ways, personally, intellectually, educated together to a certain extent. And as was common practice, when Suleiman acceded to the throne on the death of his father, he took his faithful Ibrahim with him to Istanbul.
Suleiman was 26 when he took the throne, determined to make his mark on the world, as soon as his ministers would let him.
In his early years, Suleiman had to contend, for example, with grand viziers and generals who simply refused to obey him, feeling apparently that here was a 26-year-old kid who had never seen very much in the way of action and hadn't done very much to show that people ought to, in fact, obey him.
The way to prove his mettle was on the battlefield. Every new sultan was expected to begin his reign by expanding the empire. Ottomans now controlled Kurdistan, Egypt, and the holiest cities of Islam, Mecca and Medina. Suleiman set his sights on Belgrade in Hungary, the stepping stone to Europe.
He was the head of the Ottoman dynasty, and he had certain duties to perform. One was conquest. And the first task Suleiman took upon himself a year after he ascended the Ottoman throne was to head towards Belgrade and capture it. Belgrade was very important strategically because it was from there the army could move further on west.
A year later, he turned his ambitions on the island of Rhodes. The tiny island was a troublesome outpost of Christianity in an otherwise Ottoman sea. It was also a haven for pirates, preying on Muslim trade ships. The 50,000 defenders of Rhodes manned one of the strongest forts in the world. Suleiman decided on a tactic other than relying on gunfire from his huge cannons. A new tactic, seldom used until that time.
The Ottomans are the first major force to actually develop new ways of harnessing gunpowder to the cause of military expansion in creative ways.
Ottoman sappers dug out a series of 50 tunnels near the base of the fort so they could mine its foundations. Performing this dangerous work were expendable Christian conscripts from the Balkans. The resulting explosion signaled a furious six-hour Ottoman assault. But the Turks were beaten back. Then, after 145 days of siege, the exhausted Christian defenders finally negotiated a truce. The Ottomans had won. Victory did more than deliver Rhodes to the empire. Suleiman was now a sultan to be taken seriously. His march of conquest had begun. Europe grew to fear the name of Suleiman. But within his own borders, he had another reputation. Islamic history remembers him as Kunan, the lawgiver.
Ottomans were really bureaucrats in full sense of the word. They kept every single record, and in order to control the different peoples who participated in the world of the Ottomans, they had to have very carefully sorted out legal systems.
Under Suleiman, a single legal system was defined for the sprawling empire. His laws would later become the basis of constitutions for several other nations.
Well, Suleiman was the supreme monarch of the area. He was the center of the world.
He inaugurated a classical age in Ottoman architecture, commissioning some of the most spectacular buildings the world has ever seen.
Suleiman was in a unique position of wealth and of consolidation, and he focused his attention on developing monumental architecture to commemorate his great dynasty and himself.
Great religious architecture can really give people a sense of what is at the heart of the faith. Grandeur and majesty are the things that come to mind when Muslims think about God. A building that is grand and majestic can immediately remind people of the glory of God.
Suleiman's chief architect, Sinan, was a man whose vision perfectly complemented the empire builder. Sinan perfected the signature structure of Islam, the domed mosque.